In view of time, I'd like to get started. Welcome to our panel discussion on open citations, focusing on the question, how open do we want our citations? We have five panelists, Ivan Heiby from Open Citations, Dominique, and I should have asked how to pronounce your name, Tak. Yeah. From Crossref, Shelley Stahl from American from AGU, Kathleen Scheer from COAR, and we have remote participants, Richard Jefferson from The Lens, who is joining us from Australia. And I'm very happy and also very grateful to the organization to make that possible with and allow us to have that, make some allowances for technology to make that possible. So thank you for that. Why do we want to have this panel? And why are we doing this panel? And we is myself, Bianca Kramer from Utrecht University, and Jeroen Bosman. We've been doing a lot of things in FORCE over the years, focusing on open workflows, tools and platforms, infrastructure. When we did a workshop in 2016 from the Scholarly Commons Working Group, we looked at what different components of an open infrastructure would look like and what we currently have and what we're missing. And one of the things that came out of that is what we were missing at the time in 2016 was open citations, an open citation index. That was one of the things that came out of that. Since then, a lot of things have happened with open citations that we'll touch on today, that we're really happy to see that happening. We also are involved in thinking about what does openness mean? Is that just open, like freely accessible, open to reuse, what kind of reuse, different business model, what does openness mean? So those things together, the things that are happening in the field of open citations and how they could be made more most useful and what aspects of openness are important in that respect is why we decided to put up this panel. And I'm really happy for our panelists to be able to be willing to work with us on that. I should also say that we have these panelists. We also have a lot of people not on the panel. We have a lot of perspectives not on the panel. Many of these are represented in this room, and I would like to invite everyone to feel like we're also asking you to be, in a way, part of the panel and contribute your questions and your expertise. But we also have perspectives that are not in this room. So that's also what I would like all of us to consider when we talk about this. What are the perspectives that we're missing, and what might this mean for people or groups that are not in this room? So try to have this discussion with the panel, with the room, and take into account who's not represented. I'm going to give a brief introduction, then we'll have the panelists briefly introduce themselves and give a short perspective and statement, and then we'll open this up for discussion. So open citations. Ivan already touched on this yesterday in his presentation. Since last year, we've seen a lot of growth in the citations that are openly available to Crossref, mainly through the Initiative for Open Citations, asking publishers to make their citations openly available in Crossref. And there's a figure, more or less these numbers, depends a little bit of how you query Crossref. This is the figure that is shown a lot, that from the articles, from the publications that have references available in Crossref, I think it's about 59% at the moment that are currently open, which is excellent. Of course, there's also the 20 million that are in theory available but that are not open yet. But there's also about 45 million that don't even have the references available in Crossref. So when you look at the total percentage of what's currently open, that could be open, theoretically, that's a lot less. And I plotted this earlier this week. It also means that for those publishers that already agree to have their publications open, the references of their publications open in Crossref, that it doesn't mean that all their references are open, because in many cases, publications don't have references for various technical reasons. So I plotted this, where you can see that for those publishers, the largest, these are the 20 ones with the most DORs in Crossref, what percentage of those do actually have open references available? So looking just at what's available in Crossref, there's a lot to be gained still, both in publishers moving towards making their citations open, but also for publishers that already do that, to make more references available for their articles. And we can discuss various ways that why that's not happening or how we could make that easier. But there's only one way to get to open citations. So open citations through Crossref. Ivan already discussed yesterday that that's ingested by the Initiative for Open Citations, the Open Citation Corpus. Other ways that they get citations is through EuroPMC, I think that's how you started, and also through Wikidata. Yet more ways to make citations openly available and make it possible for them to be ingested in the Open Citation Corpus is through crowdsourcing. Ivan also touched upon that yesterday. Crowdsourcing, just especially for those publications that don't have references in Crossref at all, liberate them and contribute them. There's really a nice tool called Scholarsee that enables you to do that from PDFs. And actually, the BMJ used that to make available many of their citations from older papers that were just in PDF, that were not yet in the metadata in Crossref. They used Scholarsee to make those citations available. We also have seen the recent release of iCite from NIH, a large corpus of open citations. And there's also DataCite looking at data citations and citations to other material that also have older citations as public domain. So these are really various ways in which citations can be, are, or could be made available and all under a public domain, CC0 license, or available in the public domain. So that's one approach. The other approach is work done by Microsoft Academic and by the Lens, which we'll have Richard contribute to our panel today from that perspective, that have also, within their data set and within their application, a lot of citations available. These are freely available to access and to reuse. The only difference is that they are available under an Open Data Commons BY license, so an attribution license. And we can discuss what that means a little bit further in the session. And then there are other ways, other citation databases with citations that are freely available or only available with a license, and in any way these are not licensed for reuse. So you can view them, you can access them, you cannot use them further. So, current state. Different way, different use cases for open citations. There are many different use cases that you can think of, but in general you could say perhaps that their uses could be as sources. Just in any way you would use citations, you could use open citations. But you could also see them as a way, as a part of open infrastructure, a building block to build open infrastructure. And there it comes into play, like, okay, what level of openness do you need for that? And I think open citations also offer a way to broaden citation coverage, to broaden citation coverage across different disciplines that are perhaps not as well covered in the usual sources that we use, different languages, different geographical areas. So what we would like to discuss today with the panel and with the audience is ways to increase the coverage and usability of open citations. And a couple of different aspects of that from an availability perspective might be what possible reasons are for publishers to decide to make citations open or not make citations open, technical hurdles to making citations available anyway in Crossref, reasons to choose a public domain, a CC0, or an attribution license, possible roles of repositories in providing citations. From a user's perspective, what might be different use cases for open citations? And what requirements do we have for the coverage? What coverage do we think is acceptable for the structure, for the openness? And as a subset of that question, are current and future uses dependent on the license under which citations are made available? So this is sort of to frame the discussion today. So from that, I'd like to give our panel the opportunity to briefly introduce themselves and give a quick statement about what their organizations are doing or their own perspective. And I'd like to start with Ivan.
OK. Okay. So hi everyone, and I would say sorry in advance for my voice, but I lost it a bit yesterday. So okay, I am part of the Open Citations organization. It is a scholar infrastructure. It is one of the founders of the Initiative for Open Citation, the I4OC. What we are working on. So the main thing is to publish open bibliographic and citation data using the RDF descriptions. So using the so-called semantic web technologies, which might empower the way we are query and retrieving data from these data sets. So what Open Citation provide are the data sets, the data models used, the software, and all the online services. So by online services, I mean also the API services, some searching interfaces, the dumps that people could download and re-elaborate locally on their machines. So what I have also introduced yesterday, it is the new Open Citation indexes. These data sets will include only what the citation data. So we are addressing the data in these data sets as citations only. So COCI is the first one, and it's the bigger one of this category, and it includes 435 million citations right now. It is taken from Crossref, and we have built it using the citations that are only DOI-to-DOI citations. So the other approach, which also Bianca have showed before, is CROCI. Okay, we have these funny names we use, okay, and it is the crowdsourcing strategy. So it is, we can have a big debate about that, but is a way we have thought we can move on to a next level using this this kind of strategy. So that's it, I think. And okay.
Thank you, Dominika. Can I invite you?
Hello everyone, my name is Dominika. I'm not going to pronounce my last name again. I work at Crossref. I'm a part of the R&D team. My relationship with the scholarly metadata has not started with joining Crossref. I've been involved for years now in various projects related to scholarly metadata, and in particular citation metadata. I am a fairly technical person, and my perspective is usually fairly technical as well. I absolutely don't mean to say that that the more policy related perspective is not important here. It's just that I like to leave it to other people, and I'm just focusing on other aspects of those problems, such as the availability of the data, its completeness, the quality of the data, and those are the things that Bianca also mentioned before today. I guess to prove that those concerns are still valid, I prepared these two plots that you see on my slide. Both of them were created out of the metadata in Crossref. The first one is the distribution of journal papers. Every paper in Crossref has officially assigned this information about the reference visibility level, and that it can be open, limited, or closed. And so among this group of journal papers that we have, the last category here, the 45%, are papers that are not open. So according to the official reference visibility, they are not open. And the first two categories are papers that, at least in theory, have open citations. However, as you can see, the middle category, those are the journal papers that, even though they officially have open references, but the references are simply missing from the metadata. And as you can see, this is quite a large fraction of all the journal papers. And obviously from the perspective of the user, I probably wouldn't care about the official policy. If the data is not there, I simply cannot use it. And so this shows that this problem is real and it's there, and we should be talking about it and thinking about what we could do to make this number smaller. And the second plot shows the distribution of open citations. So even if we take it farther, even if we look at citations that we do have and that are already theoretically open, we can see that in 70% of the cases, we get the citations without the DOI of the cited document, which means that the metadata is simply incomplete. Again, it doesn't mean it's useless, but it's just the possibility of using it is limited if we don't have the full information about that. And so that's me. That's my perspective, and I do believe that we should talk more about these aspects of openness in citations. Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Hello, everybody. I'm Shelley Stahl from the American Geophysical Union. I'm our Senior Director for Data Leadership. And there's a lot going on within the Earth, Space, and Environmental Sciences, but I'm going to touch on three things here. So the I4OC effort, we were an early adopter, and you can see from the article there on the bottom left that from 2017, how excited we were to let everyone know the importance of open references. And I have a little quote there having to do with the ability to create a knowledge network if we have all the references open. And this is just how we think. So why aren't the DOIs there? Why isn't everything open? Whatever we can do to help with that, and even make our own content accurate is very important. Scholix is an effort that happened through the Research Data Alliance. DataCite and Crossref, OpenAIR, the folks at ARDC came together. Oh, and the publisher community, specifically Elsevier, came together to come up with a way to link publication with data. And this is a really interesting way to connect between data sites, data that's been used more than once with for multiple publications. It's hard to do that within the publication infrastructure. So this is another possible way to connect the dots. But it all comes back through DataCite, OpenAIR, and other capabilities. So just if you're not aware of that as a publisher, this is an opportunity for you to contribute. Publishers are the ones that haven't done a really good job here. Repositories are doing an excellent job. So just heads up, guys, we've got to own this. And then the Enabling Fair Data Project comes at this from the data citation side and software citation side, that if you, in fact, are including a citation to data in a trusted, community-accepted repository, then you're actually enriching this web of information. And we, through the commitment statement for this particular effort, the publishers that have signed on, which is a good number of them, Wiley, Taylor and Francis, Elsevier, PLOS, Copernicus, I'm not going to remember them all, Nature, Science, we have to remember those, and of course the American Geophysical Union, we have 22 publications, journals, that the data will no longer be archived in the supplementary information. It must be in a repository with a proper data citation. So we should have an increase across all of these journals who are supporting the Earth, Space, and Environmental Sciences to accurately capture the actual data that's being used. And this is difficult and challenging, but it's time. Right? It's time. So thank you very much, and I look forward to the panel.
Hi, everybody. I'm Kathleen Shearer. I'm the Executive Director of CORE, which is the Confederation of Open Access Repositories. And I have to admit, I haven't thought a lot about this issue, so thank you, Bianca and Jerome, for inviting me and forcing me to think about it a little bit. So I'd just like to give you a little bit of the repository perspective. I think, you know, citations are the currency of academic research, And that's very important, and I understand the reluctance, therefore, of some organizations to not want to have citations made available because they bring value. From the core perspective and the repository perspective, of course, I think we are completely behind open citations, and we were one of the early signatories of the I4OC. But we haven't, again, thought a lot about how open we feel citations should be in terms of completely open or CC BY or so on. Some of the issues, I think, that are important from the repository perspective are that, of course, many repositories collect manuscripts that are published in journals. So how do we ensure that if there are citations from repositories for a certain article, those are combined with citations from the published article? I think something else that's really important, what you were referring to, is how do we expand citations beyond the journal? And this is really important. I mean, our keynote speaker yesterday talked about having to publish short papers about software in order to get citations. So how can we as a community think about how we can cite other types of content types like research data, software, and so on? And I think what I'd like to happen here is, as I said, CORE hasn't been thinking very deeply about these issues, but we certainly think it's important. And if you have suggestions for us in terms of work that we can do to help move this forward in the repository community, we're definitely open for those suggestions. So I'm looking forward to hearing your input about those things as well.
Thank you. And then we can move to Richard. Richard, can you hear us okay still?
Very well, thank you.
Okay, we can hear you perfectly fine too. So here's your slide. Go ahead.
Okay. My slide's not my face. That's probably wise.
Yeah, we see your face as well. Sorry.
Oh, lucky you. Double the pleasure. thank you very much for the invitation to our wonderful colleagues from the Netherlands. Those of you who don't know about the LENS, what we are, what we do, I should take a moment to outline. We've been around and serving as a public good for as long as Crossref has been established, in fact. So we've been up and running 24/7 for 20 years, serving full-text innovation knowledge as a public good. LENS is a project run by two nonprofits. One is Cambia, which founded it. That's the institution I founded 30 years ago, whose specific goal is to increase and broaden the demographics of problem solving that's informed by science and technology, so to get more and different people to be using evidence-based solving problems to attack the problems that trouble them, that constrain them. We have aligned ourselves about 10 years ago with Queensland University of Technology, where I am a professor, and jointly we run the project LENS. We've been supported over the years by virtually every major, many major international philanthropies. And we started out for many, many years not serving scholarly information per se, but serving patent information, because as you appreciate, in patents we have the largest corpus of non-copyrighted knowledge on earth, and it's rarely accessed and used wisely or at all by many scholars. So we started exposing that in a full-text indexed facility as a free and open public good. About 5 or 6 years ago, our goal, which had long been to bridge the divide between scholars and those who use scholarship to make practice changes or products, anything, in other words, that affects us, we've been trying to bridge those cultures. And so we began extracting meaningful linkages between these two corpora. And so collaborating with my pal David Lipman at NIH, who at the time was still at NIH then, now he makes the Impossible Burger, if those of you who are vegans should be impressed. But David and also the team at Crossref, we worked to extract from the body text of patents the scholarly citations. So those would be scholarly works that actually have in some ways influenced the production of products and services that are at least manifest through the patent system. The patent corpus, by the way, has about 120 million records in it right now, virtually all of them one way or another available in full text and sometimes in pretty well marked up XML standardized 1 minute. Oh, my God. Okay, thank you for that. This is really short. So in other words, I was telling you about Lens, which you don't really need to know about, I guess, if you just want to look at our Lens citation. We've been working with Microsoft Academic for the last couple of years very closely. About a third of the corpus of Microsoft Academic we've contributed to the community. Unlike Google, it's a fully open, take it off our ecosystem, do what you will with it. They ask us and you to say thank you, and that's pretty much it, to say thank you to Microsoft, and that's the degree of non-granular attribution they require. And to be clear, this is not a CC BY, and it's not an ODC BY, because frankly, this is neither a data set per se, it's really granular and can be extracted in its components, and it certainly is not copyrighted. So neither of those apply. It's the basic terms and conditions, so it's a contract. Our citations, if you look at this, I'm going to, of course, the audience can have these details with the slide to take home and grizzle about, but our data shows, in contrast to what Bianca showed earlier, where I can't use a pointer here, I don't think, but in contrast to the unknown closed references with Microsoft Academic's help, pretty much all of those are now with comprehensive open references. And with addressing the comment about partial references, which is indeed a problem from the cross-ref set, because Microsoft Academic has tamed the Bing search engine, it has tended to extract the entire corpus of references and made them available. So you'll find in many, many cases that we've inspected manually, the quality and comprehensiveness of the citations are very good. The last 10 seconds, if I may, so I'm sort of surprised to put everything in 3 minutes, that's kind of tough. But there you are. One of the things that we admire about what the machine learning group at Microsoft is doing is extracting context of each of the citations. So where it occurs in each journal publication, whether it's in materials and methods, whether it's in the body text, whether it's referred once or many times, this knowledge allows us to start getting away from the Goodhart phenomenon, including coercive citations and including fatuous and uninteresting citations, to find those using an eigenvector approach that are actually likely to be more meaningful, rather like the PageRank developed was quite a breakthrough in relevance and saliency. So I would love to talk more about this, but 3 minutes is up. So there you are.
Thanks a lot, Richard, and thanks for sticking to that time. And you'll get plenty of chance to talk more about that, hopefully, in the discussion part of the session, which we'll move to now. I'll put back up the context that we provided for this discussion, talk about ways to increase coverability and usability, thinking about that from an availability perspective and both a usage perspective. So hand it over to Jeroen now to start this.
Yeah, perhaps start with the main question there. We will have more. But the main question, of course, is for this session, what are the ways to really increase the availability and the usefulness of open citations? And I would like to first give the floor to the panelists if they want to reflect on that. Do you have any ideas to improve the coverage or usability? So,
okay. Can I go? Okay. So the crowdsourcing strategy is one of the things that Open Citation thought about in order to increase that coverage.
Yeah.
But still, we can have a lot of problems with that. For instance, we are asking authors to do a plus effort on that. So it could be also hard to say to every researcher to do that. So I think the main issue in this case for this strategy is how to convince them, how to tell them this is a good thing to do, and it could be worth to do that. So I know, it is a strategy, but from being really a good strategy and to get the good benefits from it, we have to look at these kind of problems too. So, no.
There are some journals that have limitations on references and citations. So that would probably be the first thing, to make sure we can get rid of those. If you're publishing digitally, there's no reason to have that limitation. Most don't, but that would be one. I would target that conversation and make sure we can get rid of that issue. And then you do have citations that may not make it into the references that are embedded within the body of the paper or within the supplement. And we are in transition. We're in transition to include other digital objects for the paper. And it, I think there's an extra effort on the publisher side to make sure those are captured and included and added to the paper for accuracy. So those would be the two I would highlight.
I would like to reflect briefly on the technical issue of how we could use technology to make it easier for the publishers or authors to provide rich metadata of the citations. And I'm fairly sure that most of us do realize that there are several systems out there that could be used for that, could be used to make sense of a less structured data and to extract, at least to some extent, to some accuracy, the metadata in the machine readable form. However, I would be concerned about those publishers that are fairly small. They may not even have enough resources to adopt such solutions, and they may not even realize that such possibilities are out there, and so. I'm not sure how well such publishers would be represented in a conference like this, but I do think that they should also be included in those discussions, and we should this should enable us to understand more what are in fact the problems there and where are the biggest possibilities to make it better, to make it easier for them as well.
Yes, this is kind of a three-legged stool problem. We need a multi-pronged approach where we have policies that require citations to be made openly available. We develop and build in incentives for researchers to contribute and work on that. And we provide services at the local level to help, especially in terms of the repository contribution.
Richard, could I ask for your opinion on this?
Yes, sure. first of all, I need to, because I didn't really have time to introduce it, I need to indicate that Lens is an aggregator and a provenance maintainer. So you saw in the bottom corner of our slide, there's very, very many data sets we both aggregate and normalize to present an outcome that can be used by anyone and taken off-site and used by anyone for anything. But I should point out that while a very large number of our resources come from Microsoft Academic on the scholarly side, and those are widely available, they dwarf what's available in the open community otherwise, and they're still open. So I do not understand why it's not more of a driving discussion within the open citation and generally the open access community that this resource is being made as a public good, not just a free teaser into the surveillance capitalism. So we spend a lot of time trying to normalize diverse data feeds into this, ranging from, of course, the Crossroads data to Core, to PubMed Central, to what have you. And we find that this is a very useful approach to take what we call a meta record, a Lens ID-driven meta record, and actually aggregate the diverse sources so we can optimize a display record that has the best possible form of that, determined by a variety of different approaches. So in terms of availability, I think we already have very good availability. I would, as somebody who doesn't even particularly like artificial intelligence and machine learning, and I'm certainly not a practitioner of it, I look at what Microsoft and its team is doing and others of very large corporations that actually have, for a change, a bit of public good as one of their outcomes. They're solving the problem. I don't see, if I look asymptotically, is the problem of open citations that we have to get more people to be slaves to machines or more machines to be slaves to people? I think it's basically a problem that's about to be solved. And if you look at the size of the MAG data set and the quality, I would be hard-pressed to think that if you're evidence-driven, you'd disagree.
That might actually be, thank you, might be a very good point to turn this to the audience. Is there anyone here who has reflection on what any of the panelists brought up, or any additional views, or... Can you please state also your name and where you're from?
Thank you. My name is Sam Toplitsky. I'm the Open Science Librarian at UC Berkeley. And I wanted to suggest a use case.
I cannot hear if that matters.
Oh. Would you mind coming up here and?
Sure.
No, it's just needs to be spoken into the microphone better, please.
Is this better?
Well, it sounds like it's in a fish tank, but I can't really hear, but it's okay.
Would you mind coming up and asking your question here?
Okay.
Sorry.
No, that's
working
okay.
Within technology.
Can I hear you that?
Yeah.
Is that better for you?
It's wonderful.
Okay. Hello, everyone. I didn't mean for this to be a grand question. Nonetheless. So the question I have, or the comment I have, is related to use case, and this is something I'm working on my campus. As I said, I'm the Open Science Librarian at Berkeley, and I work a lot with graduate students in physical sciences, and the work we're trying to do is bring more diverse voices into the work they're doing. And the term I've heard used that relates to this conversation is inclusive citations, and I've kind of struggled with this, and I welcome feedback if this is sort of not the appropriate kind of connection. But the idea is that the official literature that people are using should be reflective of diverse voices and should bring diverse voices into the literature in an official way. And I guess the parallel would be many departments on my campus will make an effort to have their seminar series be increasingly diverse, racially, gender-wise, what have you. And that's very visible to people, and it's very visible to students who may be from underrepresented groups. They come, they see that, they feel more welcome, they see a diverse range of voices. But then that doesn't carry through with citations and the kind of measures that count for people. On the flip side of that, I think, well, that's really weird. That's like a kind of big privacy violation. Do people want their gender as part of their citation information? That's not the way you want to seek something out. You don't want to say, give me, you know, click a box or something in a search engine to reveal that. So then, you know, what is there a better way to go about that, to bring diverse voices in using citations? Anyway, that's kind of my thought. So.
Any reflections on that? Any other reflections? Cameron, do you want to try speaking in the mic and speaking clearly in the mic and see if Richard can hear you?
I can try.
How's that, Richard? How's that for you? Can you hear Cameron? If you speak.
I'm sorry. Listen.
No.
Forget me.
No.
We will not forget you. Cameron, would you mind? Then I will ask. And remember what I said in the beginning, that we consider also people, the opinions in the room, to be part of the panel. This is one way to make this physical.
See, this way you can see me, Richard.
Wonderful. Thank you, mate.
I really want to sort of back up what Richard is saying, is there's the sources of data, and particularly what Microsoft Academic has done, has made a lot more of this available. It's also going to cause us a problem. There's a thing that we're not quite surfacing yet, which is there are two very different use cases for citations. You've heard both of them. One of them is to actually understand what is going on and understand the connections between knowledge, which is what I think most of us in the room are interested in. But the other is as a lever to change behavior through awarding credit. In the credit system, so when I've shown Microsoft Academic data to bibliometricians, they say the numbers are too big. It has to be more curated. It has to be more structured and controlled. and that's actually, and you know, while, and I think I agree with the snark, it's not something we really want to be doing, but it's a reality of achieving some of the goals that we want with some of these tools. And that causes a challenge in that we do kind of have the data, at least for some set of corpus of publications and for some set of kinds of links between publications. But we need to have a serious conversation about the authority control processes by which we can move that around. So do we need to get that into Crossref? And if we can get it from Microsoft Academic to Crossref, then we have to break a whole set of rules around how Crossref currently works, because that would involve a separate authority making claims about citations. And we have to have a really serious conversation about what a citation is and which ones we care about. Is a footnote a citation? Is a reference to a data set a citation? And so as we're capturing all these things, how do we put them in? So I think there's a conversation. We can move the data around. We've got the data. We can expand the data. We can make the data more inclusive. All of those things are now within our grasp, I think. The challenge is, how do we get this into curated spaces and trusted spaces?
Can I respond to that?
Yeah, just briefly, because we want to also move on to another set of questions, but briefly, yes.
No, I thought, okay. Briefly, it seems like, of course, there's no reason to take it into Crossref. Why would you? It's a publisher's association, rules-driven, and that's all it is. It's a publisher's association. So why would you do that? I mean, you can make a third-party one. We are basically that. Or you can use a different third-party one. I mean, make it a neutral venue if you wish that doesn't involve rules from a bunch of for-profit publishers. There's no reason to take it into Crossref. Take Crossref into you. That's what we've done. It works really well. Sorry.
Okay, thank you. We would now like to really get you active in the room by asking the next question. This is just try to imagine the brave new world where we have all these item-to-item citations that can be papers, but perhaps also all the other types of outcomes. And if you have them in a way that is that they are fully open and usable for anything that you can imagine, what would you imagine? So what we would like to ask you is to take 2-3 minutes to really think about it and discuss with your neighbor. So try to come up together with use cases for a world in which we have fully open citations for all research output that's out there. So please talk to each other and think about use cases for this type of information. It may become noisy, so that's okay.
Remember, you're all the panel. Thank you. So another 30 seconds. Okay, thank you for that. This is what I like about FORCE, really people getting all their creativity out and talking to each other about these things. Because we have some 40 tables here, probably at each of these tables a nice idea has come up and you have enriched each other with that. So that's great. So we want to have just one or two of these ideas shared in this room, plenary. So is there anyone here that wants to share a great idea that you have come up with or that you have heard? For instance, here at this table. I'm sorry, Richard, probably you're not going to hear this, so we will try to repeat it.
Yeah, my perspective is this open citation could be used in the ranking system, whether it's a national or international level rankings. At present, they used to depend on particular commercial database. Even database one shows so-and-so numbers, then database two shows so-and-so numbers. There itself, there is a large difference due to they have different coverage. Whereas if you have this open citation, you used to take even resources which is not indexed, the citation count, it will come from the resources it is not covered, not indexed in any of the citation commercial database, whatever they have. It will improve the national as well as international level ranking system. They can make use of this open citation. It will be a great benefit for everyone.
That's okay, thank you. Just Richard, for you to summarize this. Here was a suggestion to use open citations to improve university rankings and make sure that they are more reliable, that you're not dependent on any commercial provider, and that they are more covering more also of local output.
And Shelley from the panel, you want to reflect on that?
This was the entire panel working together. So combining the issues that we have with the Global South, smaller journals that are servicing this community, as well as the fact that we've got this significant number of publications coming in without citations, we think there's a working group opportunity to figure out to work with each of the journals, help them realize what's missing. We think there's just a knowledge gap there with some of the smaller journals that could use some services, and Crossref could use some help trying to bridge that gap, and I bet we could probably do it.
Thank you. I'll file that thought.
Any other ideas in the room, that great idea that you heard and want to share? Yeah, there's one over there.
To Shelley's point, and I know that there are folks here in the room from like Open Journal Systems, so they've recently, in the newest version of OJS, there's like a reference plugin. A lot of the new Crossref members that we work with are small international open access publishers, and we also work with the biggest open access publishers. And I think a lot of what I'm concerned about in my day-to-day work is exactly what you're saying. How can we support them? Dominique is a whiz at reference extraction, so that always gives me hope. But again, working with systems like Open Journal Systems, who can build these sort of plugins, etc., that would help serve the newest and the fastest growing types of members that we will see, alongside like the education part and stuff like that, is something that that we're seeing a real interest in and a real push on how to do this, but equally we're limited in term, you know, that covers a whole swathe of the new members that we're seeing, but then equally there will be ones who don't have that, and I think we just need to continually work to make that easier. And I think that part is part of the sort of inclusivity aspect as well, because some of those publications won't be listed in other databases, and that doesn't mean that what they're citing isn't important.
Okay, yeah, thanks very much. I really like what's happening, that we're really having a discussion in the room and with panelists. I also wish we could continue this discussion, but we're nearing the full hour, so we want to sort of wrap up. I want to wrap up with two things. First of all, building on what Shelley said, and this is not a plan, but I would like to suggest for the pop-up sessions during lunch that people who want to continue this discussion, we could do so over lunch. So this is my suggestion for a pop-up session. And secondly, we'd like to finish with one general question for the whole audience and the panel, which is, do you think that citation data for those applications that you have in mind and that you can envision, do you think that citation data for that need to be in the public domain or not? And I'd just like to see a raise of hands for people who think that citation data should ultimately be in the public domain. And conversely, who doesn't think that's strictly necessary and that could be under other licenses as well? Okay, great. Thank you. As I said, I think there are different aspects to this, different aspects on usability that would be very interesting to discuss further. I would really like to thank all of you for participating, but especially our panelists for contributing. First of all, Richard, for staying up late and contributing all the way from Australia. And Ivan, Dominika, Shelley, and Kathleen here in the room. So please give our panelists a big round of applause. And again, thank you all for your participation and enjoy the rest of the session.